one and all. Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our service of worship. And good to see a good congregation back in the meeting house. And we trust we'll all be blessed as we join and worship together in our refurbished building. Can I welcome to your pulpit this morning the Reverend David Murphy. David, lovely to have you back again. Thank you for coming and taking the service. And also any visitors who will be with us, including those who will be watching on live stream. And whether you're watching from London or Londonderry or anywhere else in between, we trust that we will all know and feel the presence of Almighty God as we join together to worship and give Him praise. Our announcements you will have in your announcement sheet, and just briefly through them. Toddlers, Tuesday morning, 9:30, Anchor Boys in the Tuesday evening, and we're still keen to see wee fellas come along and join. Any that haven't been with us, you'll be very welcome to send them on. Rainbows, Brownies, Thursday, prayer time in the church hall in the John Davy Hall on Wednesday evening, and then the company section and junior section will meet on Friday night. Ballylagan, our neighbours down in Ballylagan, Reformed Presbyterian, invite you to a big breakfast on Saturday morning between 8 a.m. and 11 a.m. and donations are in aid of Blytheswood Care Shoebox Appeal. Can I ask the committee to wait briefly after this morning's service? When we were clearing out the church for the renovations, we had to take everything out. There were footstools taken out from some pews. There were Bibles, hymn books. Some have names of family members who are long gone. So we would like to get rid of everything. We're not bringing all that stuff back in again. And if anybody had a Bible or a hymn book belonging to a father or a grandfather in the pew, if you come to the church tomorrow evening, we'll get it to you. And the same with footstools or anything else. If you want them, come and get them and take them with you, please. You'll remember the Harvest Mission weekend for the rededication of our meeting house on Friday the 4th of October at 7:30, when the speaker will be the Reverend Mark Neely, and the rededication will be by the moderator, Dr. Murray. The Saturday night is the congregational dinner in the church hall, and when I arrived, I had extra menus in this here, but the extra menus are all gone. But if you need a menu, please speak to us and call at the house and get one. Today was to be the last day for taking orders, but we'll stretch it a day or two. You know where we live, and if you forgot to bring your menu with you, drop it in at the house sometime through the week, please, for we have numbers to put together and the menus all to put together for the caterers. So do remember it and come along. And if you have family friends who grew up in the congregation and they would like to come, by all means bring them with you. The Sunday will be the Harvest Thanksgiving service also, morning and evening, and the Reverend Neely will also conduct and preach. And the evening service, the guest choir will be the men's choir from Tully Allen and Mount Norris Presbyterian Churches in South Armagh. And if you are a good baker, male or female, and you want to provide sandwiches and tray bakes for the Friday evening service, there's a sheet at the back, you can add your name to it. I've been asked to say a big thank you to those who have provided recipes for the book that's being prepared, and I'm told to say that any type of recipe will be very welcome. So no matter what it is, bring it along, give it to Sandra, and it will be very much appreciated. I think that would be all the announcements I have. If anybody wants any invitation cards, I still have some of those, so I'll hand over now to David.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
Could I say thank you to William for his very kind words of welcome, and it is, of course, my privilege to be with you again here in Aghadowey and to lead in the morning service of worship and to share with you on this special Sunday morning as you return back into the meeting house after your renovations and the work that has been carried out. We come as a congregation to worship God. In Ephesians chapter 3 and from verse 20, we read these words: "Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Jesus Christ throughout all generations, forever and ever." And as we worship God today, may we know the blessing of God's ability to constantly exceed our expectations of him. We come to worship God, and we do that as we sing together the lovely words of Psalm number 100, "All people that on earth do dwell." We join together now in prayer. Let us pray. Our Father, your word tells us that upon the completion of the building of the temple, your servant David offered prayer, and that he said, "Praise be to you, Lord. O Lord God of our father Israel, from everlasting to everlasting. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power, and the glory and the majesty and the splendor, for everything in heaven and earth is yours. Yours, O Lord, is the kingdom. You are exalted as head over all. Wealth and honor come from you. You are the ruler of all things. In your hands are strength and power to exalt and give strength to all. Now, our God, we give you thanks and praise for your glorious name. And so, our Father, as your people long ago gathered, and as they bowed before you in prayer, and yet lifted up their voices to you, coming with words of adoration and praise and thanksgiving. So, today, as a congregation of your people, we similarly come and we lift up your high and your holy name. We acknowledge that in your hands are strength and power to exalt and to give strength to all. And so, our Father, we come in our time, in our day, and in our generation to give you thanks and to praise your glorious name. For as we have just been singing, you are good, your mercy is everlasting, and your truth endures to all generations. Our Father, we pray that you will bless us in these moments as we gather here today on this Lord's Day. Bless us individually and bless us collectively with a very real sense of your presence. Because when we know your presence, we know your perfect peace. And Father, help us to worship you in spirit and in truth. And we pray for all of these things in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. I want to read now from the scriptures, and we're going to turn to read a few verses from Matthew chapter 16, and you will find that on the Pew Bible. Page number 983, Matthew chapter 16, and we're going to read from verse 13 through to verse 20. And here we have Peter's confession of Christ. Let us hear the word of God. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say the Son of Man is?" They replied, "Some say John the Baptist, others say Elijah, and still others Jeremiah or one of the prophets." "But what about you?" he asked. "Who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." Jesus replied, "Blessed are you, Simon, son of Jonah, for this was not revealed to you by man, but by my Father in heaven. And I tell you that you are Peter, and on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of Hades will not overcome it. I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven, and whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." Then he warned his disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Christ. And we end at verse 20 of the chapter and ask for God's blessing to rest upon this reading of his word. I'm going to invite the boys and girls now to come up to the front, and I will go down and join with you just for a few moments.
Famous always do the things that God wants us to do. And sometimes we don't do the things that God would want us to do. And the Bible calls that sin. And there is another slide here that tells us from Romans chapter 3, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. We have all sinned, and we all have that tendency to be crooked and to go off on our own and not do what God would want us to do. And the next slide says, and the wages of sin is death. And that's God's warning to us. Because of our sin, we face eternal death. But there is good news. And the good news is in the next verse. The gift of God is eternal life through our Lord Jesus Christ. Think of the tar, it's crooked. Think of what the Bible says to us. We've all sinned, and our sin needs to be dealt with. And our sin has been dealt with through God's Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And God's gift to us is eternal life when we put our faith and our trust in Him. When we build our lives upon Jesus, the sure foundation, because when we do that, then we will know His help and His guidance and His power to live our lives in a way that will please Him and bring glory to Him. We'll sing together our children's hymn this morning, and it is, blessed be the name of the Lord, and indeed we bless the name of the Lord, and we thank Him for all that He's done for us to take away our sin and to give us the gift of eternal life.
The name of the Lord, most high.
We continue now to worship God as we bring our offering, and as we do so, the choir will sing Love of God. Let us pray together. Our Father, we thank you for the opportunity in our service of worship to give of our resources to the work of your church. And here we give today to the work of our Presbyterian Church in Ireland and its various outreaches and agencies at home and overseas. And here we give to the work of this congregation. Our Father, we pray that you will indeed bless that which we have presented in our gifts, in our tithes, and in our offerings. And may all be used wisely indeed, for the glory of your name. And our Father, we thank you for the resources that have been used over recent times here in this place to enhance the facilities of the meeting house. And we thank you for that work and for its completion and for all that has been done to bring that added glory and beauty to this building. And Father, we thank you for those who in generations past attended to the material needs of the congregation in providing the resources and the buildings needed to reach out into this community and district. And we thank you that in this present generation, you have set it upon the hearts and minds of your people to improve their facilities for the generations yet to come. And Father, we pray for the work of the congregation and all the various activities and organizations that come under the jurisdiction of this congregation. And Father, we pray that many will come to know Jesus Christ as their strong tower, as their loving Savior, as their Redeemer, Master, and Friend, as the good seed of your word is sown, not just through the preaching on the Lord's Day, but through the various activities and youth organizations. Our Father, we pray that your church here will grow as men and women and boys and girls and young people accept Jesus Christ as their Savior and build their lives upon him, the rock of all ages. Our Father, we pray for the program of events that will mark the rededication of the meeting house. We pray for the Harvest Mission weekend and for the Reverend Mark Neely as he will come to speak at the various events and services. Our Father, we pray for the special music by the church choir and for the Sunday school children and for others. And we pray for the choir from Tully Allen and Mount Norris as they too will come and share the message of the gospel in song. Father, for all of these events and for all who will participate in them and for all who will provide for them in a practical way, we pray this morning for your blessing. And as we remember the needs of the congregation, we again recall in prayer those who are laid aside because of sickness at home or in hospital, asking, O God, that you will minister your healing touch to them. And we remember those who have been bereaved, who today mourn greatly the loss of a dear and loved one. And we pray that you will surround all who mourn with your everlasting arms. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. We're going to sing together now our next congregational praise entitled Ancient Words.
Words of love.
James Philip from Holyrood Abbey Church, Edinburgh, in his very, very useful and very helpful exposition of the Westminster Confession of Faith, deals at great length with that chapter of the Confession relative to the Word of God, relative particularly to the subject of the church. He poses many questions about the church in the context of Scripture. What is the church? Who are its members? What are the marks of the church? How is the church built up? And who is the sole king and head of the church? It's not my intention this morning or now this afternoon to deal in great detail with all of those thought-provoking questions, but rather just to think about one or two. What is the church? And what are some of the characteristics or the hallmarks of it? The word church translates a Greek word, ecclesia, from which we get the word ecclesiastical, which literally means a calling out. And in the context of the New Testament, it refers to a company of people who have been called out and gathered together by God. The church, therefore, by definition, is a company of called out ones. With that word ecclesia being equivalent to the Old Testament Hebrew word kahal, which means the congregation of the Lord or the assembly of the Lord's people. We find this particular word used in that context in Deuteronomy 4 and verse 10. The church, according to the testimony of Scripture, is therefore not to be viewed in terms of a particular institution, a structure, a framework, a building, or a place, but rather it is to be viewed in terms of people, in terms of those who love the Lord Jesus, who have been redeemed by his precious blood, those who have been effectually called to embrace Christ as he is freely offered to us in the gospel. The church is the sum total of all those in heaven and on earth who have come to faith in Jesus Christ, who receive and rest upon him alone for their salvation, and who can stand with Peter and confess as he did in response to a question from Jesus in John's Gospel, chapter 6, and say, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. We believe and we know that you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. What a wonderful affirmation. What a wonderful testimony. And echoes there, surely, of that great testimony and confession of Peter's that we read earlier in the service today from Matthew chapter 16. Jesus is asking his disciples a question. He asks them a general question to start off with. He says, who do the people think I am? And they answered and they said, well, some people think you're John the Baptist. Some people think you're Elijah or Jeremiah or one of the prophets. But then he asks them a specific question, one just for his disciples. Who do you say I am? And then Peter, as he often did, he speaks on behalf of the rest and he says, you are Christ, the Son of the living God. And on the basis of that solid confession, which points to Christ as the immovable foundation rock, Jesus says, on that, I will build my church. The church consists of all those who down through the running centuries have come to faith in Jesus Christ, who have been set in a right relationship with God the Father, not because of their own merits or labors, but because of the righteousness of Christ imputed to them, as the Catechism says, and received by faith. Faith alone. In the scriptures, we find many illustrations being used to portray the church in union with Christ. In Ephesians 5, for example, Paul illustrates this union by giving to us a marriage picture, portraying Christ in the role of the husband and the church in the role of his wife, the bride and the bridegroom. The church which he loved and gave himself for. Paul again in Ephesians 1 and in a fuller treatment in 1 Corinthians 12 gives us another picture of the church, this time as the body of Christ, with Christ again as the head of the body. The body, as we know it physically, has many parts and many members, and each has its own particular role and function to perform. And so it is in a spiritual sense. For the Church of Jesus Christ has within itself all kinds and conditions of people, young and old, rich and poor, male and female. It embraces a great company of people of all ages, from all various cultural backgrounds, denominations, and so on. Yet these all dovetail together into that one body over which Christ is Master and Lord. And a further illustration, and yet one that does not exhaust the New Testament's portrayal of the church, is the one where Paul conveys to us the picture of the true church by using the symbol or the image of a building. In Ephesians 2, Paul speaks of the church as a building built on the foundation of the prophets and the apostles, with Christ Jesus himself as the chief cornerstone. And here we see the pivotal and the controlling position of Christ. Here he is the cornerstone of a building. And what does a cornerstone suggest to us? Well, it suggests, I think, that as well as being part of the foundation and therefore supporting the superstructure, it is also set in such a way that it determines the shape and the design of the walls themselves. For the other stones must adjust themselves to fit in with the cornerstone. And so it is in the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. Believers who are, as Peter says in 1 Peter 2, who are living stones, must adjust and regulate their lives in accordance with the will of Christ, who is the chief corner stone. And I wonder, as professing Christians today, do we all regulate our lives to conform to the path and direction that Christ has set for us? Are we really following the course determined by the angle of the cornerstone? Are we responding to the head of the body in the same way as our physical bodies respond and act to the commands of the brain? And are we, as Peter challenged the church long ago, and as he still challenges the church today through the inspired words of Scripture, are we living lives worthy of our calling and worthy of the one who has called us? Does the way we entertain ourselves on a Saturday evening or behave when we go to work on a Monday through the week and to our various social and leisure time activities, does our behavior match that which we show in the Lord's day? Are we living holy lives? Peter says, the one who called you into the church is holy, so you must be holy too. Be holy because I am holy, says the Lord. Holiness is one of the essential marks of the true church. It is what Jesus prayed for in John chapter 17. He prayed and said, sanctify them with thy word of truth. Peter has confessed in Matthew 16, our passage today, Jesus to be the Christ. And on the basis of that mighty truth, as on a rock, Jesus says, I will build my church. And then he goes on to say, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it. Implicit, I believe, in the second part of that statement is a timely warning to the church in all generations that Satan will do all in his power to prevent the people of God from living a holy life, from living a life that is marked by prayer, from living a life that is saturated in the Word of God from living a life that is marked by service for the Master. For even though you have experienced the new birth, even though you have been saved from the guilt and the penalty of your sin through faith and trust in the Lord Jesus, it doesn't mean that the devil is finished with you. It doesn't mean that he has no further interest in you. For there is nothing he wants more than to upset and to destroy and to ruin your profession and your walk with God. And he will still come to stir up the dregs of sin in our lives and lead us away from the priorities that ought to be ours as individuals and as a congregation of God's people. He will still come along and try to take you away from the place and the activity of prayer. He will still come along and fill your life with so many things that you neglect the Word of God. Be holy, says God, because I, your God, am holy. We are to be holy because God has elected us for this very purpose. In Ephesians chapter 1 and verse 4, we read, he chose us in him that is in Christ before the creation of the world to be holy and blameless in his sight. And so as members of the church, we are exhorted to be dedicated. We are exhorted to be committed. And to be so may often involve having to pay a price. For the world with its ideas and ideals and values and standards will always try to seduce us away from the narrow path onto the broad road that leads to destruction. Yes, the devil is always there seeking to draw us away from the things of God. He will play on our desire for an easy life. He will exploit our human weaknesses that would lead us to capitulate and to compromise with respect to his word and truth. He will use the attraction of affluence and the magnet of materialism to water down and destroy our Christian profession. But let me say once again, in this service of worship, let us again remind ourselves afresh that it is a profound and all-important truth that as sin lives, as the flesh lives, as the devil lives, so Jesus lives too. And it is a blessing that whatever strength these may have to ruin us, Jesus has still greater power to save us, to heal us, to cleanse us, and to keep us. I remember going to visit an elderly man when I was in First Cookstown Presbyterian Church, and He was a man who lived his life in darkness because he was blind. But he had a very, very strong faith in the Lord Jesus. And he said to me, wherever you go in your life and ministry, remember, yes, the devil is mighty, but the Lord Jesus is almighty. And was not this the message he gave through John the Apostle to the persecuted church of Smyrna in Revelation 2, to the faithful church of Philadelphia in Revelation 3, two churches that received no words of condemnation or rebuke, for they were being faithful and true to the cause of Christ. Oh yes, they were being slandered and persecuted and ridiculed and mocked, as we often still are today. When we try to take our stand for Christ in this world, and Jesus said to those two churches in Smyrna and Philadelphia, he says, I know your affliction. And don't ever forget that the day will come when those who slander and lie about you for my sake will be caused to fall down at your feet and acknowledge that I have loved you. Wonderful words, I think, of encouragement for the church of the Lord Jesus Christ today. Wonderful words of encouragement for all of us who profess the Christian faith in this often very godless and arrogant and indifferent 21st century. God says, I have loved you. When God says it, when God says, I have loved you, then all the enemies of God and all the enemies of his church and his purposes will have to come and bow down before God's beloved, because his love is the love of the Lord of the universe. It is a love that is stronger even than death. For as Paul says, nothing can separate us from the love of God, nothing. From the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. If you are a Christian today and facing difficult circumstances in your own place and station, then I want to tell you that God, the Lord of eternal glory, in the person of his Son, the King of Kings, has loved you. And he will never let you go. And that truth is the anchor that the church needs to hold onto tightly today. Have you got that anchor this afternoon? The anchor that is steadfast and sure? For I tell you that the church of Jesus Christ is the only body in the world with an absolutely secure future. Oh yes, people will invest for the future in the stock exchange or in this or that political or social philosophy. But the Church of Jesus Christ is the only body that constant will remain. the Lord will still reign. When all human institutions fail, and God will still be God when our history has run its course. And so may I ask you finally this afternoon now, are you a member of the church? That question doesn't mean, do you have your name on the roll of this or some other congregation or fellowship? I mean, are you one who has heard the call of Jesus, been brought to him, and by his shed blood, cleansed from your sin and fitted for glory? For that's what makes you a member of the church of which the scriptures speak. Are you a member not in name but in reality? Have you done business with Jesus so that he is, and you know this to be absolutely sure, that he is your Savior, he is your Lord, and he is your friend? If you have, and he is, then I tell you, your future is secure. Oh yes, it won't be trouble-free, but it is secure. For Jesus says, I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not prevail against it. Praise be to God for his church, the church which he hath purchased with his own precious blood. Let us pray together. Lord God, we adore you because you come to us. We adore you because you will come to us at the end. You will be with us at the hour of death. You will still reign supreme when all human institutions fail. And you will still be God when our history has run its course. We welcome you, the God who comes. Come to us now in the power of Jesus Christ our Lord, in whose name we pray. Amen. We're going to conclude our worship today as we sing our final congregational praise, a piece entitled Cornerstone.
Built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. My hope is built and righteousness. I dare darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. I stand alone, cornerstone, Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. His oath is covenant, His blood, support me.
Now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God our Heavenly Father and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all this day and forevermore. Amen.